IVM.
How to Citizen is an IVM production. And if you like this show, you should also check out the other IVM shows like The Sponge Podcast, hosted by veteran adman and author Ambi Parameswaran. He recounts his interactions with clients and lets us in on all the leadership lessons he learned from them through the years. New episodes out every Monday on the IVM Podcast app, ivmpodcast.com, or wherever you listen to your podcasts. Hello and welcome to How to Citizen. This is the penultimate episode of this season. We are at chapter 9, Confronting Privilege. No, that's not what it's called. We are not confronting anything anymore, thankfully. This chapter is called Public Facilities, where we are joined by comedian extraordinaire and my favorite columnist. Used to be a columnist. Please come back and become a columnist. Stupidus Maximus, aka Ashish Shakya. In this chapter, we spoke about how public facilities work in Bombay, how they work in Delhi. Basically, it was just a competition between Delhi Metro and Mumbai locals. Spoiler alert, Delhi won. We also talk about how privilege works when it comes to accessing public facilities, and our very fun civics book also points that out very subtly and in so many ways. So let's get schooling and let's get schooled. Hello guys, hello, I'm Meghnad, hi.
I am Shreyas.
And we have a very special guest with us. I first knew him as Stupidus Maximus.
Ah.
I didn't even know his name. I read his columns. I was a big fan. So there are three columnists I followed actively. One was Pratap Bhanu Mehta, because he's the god of public policy.
Yes.
No denying that.
Yes.
Second is Mithali Sarin from Business Standard. And the third is Stupidus Maximus, who is Ashish Shakya.
Yeah. That is such exalted company, PBM and Mithali Sarin. I really like both of their work.
Yeah.
I just think they have fewer dick jokes than mine. I'm just saying, it's not a comment on their quality, but you know, imagine a Pratap Bhanu Mehta column, but with some.
You are a columnist turned comedian, aren't you? Or you're a writer turned comedian.
You know, I'm a writer turned comedian, but I think we started off as a writer, so at the base of it, at the core of it, I'm a writer, and everything else has sort of come from there. Whether it's stand up, whether it's any form of fiction writing, whether it's non-fiction writing for television, and all of that has come from there. Even with stand up, like when we started, it was very writerly, and because that's all we knew.
Yeah.
At least people like me. In fact, a lot of people from that time also were a little writerly, in the sense that you constructed like punchlines and you went up on stage with, and then sort of you like learned how to perform and be better on stage and not just make it a writerly thing.
Right.
But yeah, at the start, I mean, I think I'll always be a writer, I think, because that's the core skill based on which everything else is
dependent on.
Text.
Yeah, but so we have Ashish Shakya.
Yeah.
Ashish Shakya has already introduced himself. Yeah. Or I have introduced
him. You've introduced Stupidus Maximus. Yeah. I've been reading his column, Stupidus Maximus. I'm like, I'll take that.
So people didn't know that it was you for a long time, right? When you were writing that column?
No, I think that's just Meghnad.
I didn't care.
How do you not know? It's my name is everywhere. Paper mein photo ke saath aata tha. Uspe naam likha tha. Stupidus Maximus mera Twitter handle tha.
I know. His Twitter handle, so I used to follow through that.
Right?
I didn't care about his name. Because I follow people through Twitter. Yeah, it's like, I didn't give my name on Twitter for the longest time. So it's like,
No, I was like, guys, please know my name. Mere ko jao. Main bahut attention ho rahi. Mujhe chahiye mera naam. That is the only reason
I
got into writing.
But you stopped writing columns, no?
It was unintentional, this break, because there was too much happening at work at AIB, and I didn't have the time, and a lot of what was happening was also topical news based comedy.
Right.
So there was no, like, on a season one, so there was no way I could do that and then still have material left.
Right.
I had no time.
Right.
And just there was work kept piling up, so I just didn't get back to it. Some of it was creative fatigue, because I'd been kind of writing for like 6 years straight, that column. Now I kind of miss it. It's been a while since I wrote the.
So this podcast format is where Ashish Shakya announces his column is coming back.
Woo!
Yeah.
Yes, let's go with that.
Yes, absolutely. So that's great news.
Slightly fake news, but fine. Like, hoega. I haven't figured out where exactly, but my
Okay, so basically, for those of you who are listening on episode 9 right now, that would be weird. So you better go back and listen to other episodes. But if you are just joining in at episode 9, this podcast is about civics.
Yes. Yeah?
So the concept is that you have a civics chapter in front of
correct.
You.
Correct.
Which we have sent you 24 hours before.
Yes.
Yeah. And you had to read it, and now we are going to talk about it, right? So to begin with, where did you go to school?
For the most part, I think I was in APJ school in New Bombay. It was a CBSE school, part of the APJ family.
Mm-hmm.
But it was, at the time, this is 1995, right? At the time, it was one of those little stepchildren of the APJ family. Like, because when you went to the, it had schools in Delhi and Punjab, right? And when you went for the other school meets or whatever, you went to the Delhi school, Sheikh Sarai and whatnot, and it had fucking lawns and basketball courts and swimming pools and auditoriums. We had like one patch of dirt with stray dogs and shit. So you felt a little neglected.
Basically, others had privilege. He did.
Yeah. Felt very bad because technically, naam tha, uniform same tha, lekin.
So whenever some guest comes in and we are asking them about the school, right? So it's like some describe their school, magnificent schools with like giant playgrounds, basketball court, etc. So unke paas privilege.
Wo Delhi wale aapke honge. क्योंकि बॉम्बे में जगह ही नहीं है यार, तुम कहाँ बनाओगे? दिल्ली में हर फकोल स्कूल के पास पे इतना बड़ा ग्राउंड है।
आई रिसेंटली फाउंड आउट एक्चुअली दैट आम आदमी पार्टी हैज डन लाइक अ फैसिनेटिंग जॉब व्हिच वी विल एक्चुअली टॉक अबाउट।
यस यस वी शुड,
बिकॉज देयर स्कूल्स ऑल अराउंड 1000 ऑफ देम, ऑल ऑफ देम हैव अ प्लेग्राउंड नाउ।
या इट लुक्स स्पेक्टेक्युलर,
इट्स क्रेजी। आई मीन आई एम लाइक सीरियसली, कहाँ जगह अवेलेबल था पहले से? ओके,
हैव यू सीन लाइक the stuff they've been putting on online, just the videos and like a little bit of the coverage of the schools. Atishi has done such a good job. It's ridiculous. And it's Sisodia, I think.
Yeah, Sisodia.
Yeah. Just insane.
And that is a part of public facilities, which is what we are going to talk about today. But before we do that, tell us, were you a good student and did you like civics?
Yes and no. I was a good student in the academic sense of the term. Like I got marks.
You were in a CBSE school?
I was in a CBSE school. Civics, I have no real memory of. Like civics was again like the stepchild of the 10 mark ka aata tha ya 20 mark ka aata tha boards mein, aisa kuch to tha na, something stupid like that. Some very low amount. The minute somebody said Zila Parishad, like I would fall asleep. So it was Pavlovian almost. Zila Parishad khatam, just khatam, full Manchurian candidate. Zila khatam. It's how can you in the afternoon you're sitting in a class and the teacher is like, today I'm going to talk about Zila Parishad. Nobody cares. You're 14. You don't give a shit.
Yeah.
How was at 33, you barely
give a shit.
How was the teacher?
Immaterial.
Immaterial.
You know, subject matter is the problem.
Yeah, like Amitabh Bachchan, whatever. Like Michael Jackson could have come in and agar wo Zila Parishad bolta, main nikal jata.
Zila Parishad actually reminded me. I had written this answer on Zila. Bahut memorize kiya tha. I had spelt it wrong. With one L instead of two. Right?
Oh yeah. Shit.
0 marks diya mere ko.
यही तो था हरामपंथी, मतलब दिस इज नॉट लर्निंग, दिस इज जस्ट माइंडलेस फकिंग
टॉर्चर, इट्स हॉरिफाइंग. बट या आई मीन आई फील यू अबाउट द सिविक्स देयर, लाइक यू नो व्हाट
आई हैव वन स्ट्रांग मेमोरी अबाउट सिविक्स. 10th बोर्ड्स का प्रेप टाइम चल रहा था. This is the year I was 15. So, and my parents, in all their wisdom, decided to buy me a computer that very time.
Oh.
And my 10th board's prep leave.
That's the opposite of what parents usually do.
Yeah, but fuck it. As a 15-year-old, I got internet in my house. Like, I used to go to my friend's house in cyber cafes before, but in my house, for the first time, just before my board exam, and I was like, main fail hone wala hun. And one day, the 2-3 days after it was installed, like, I never got time to myself. Like, my parents always home. They went somewhere for the day, and I was supposed to be studying civics that day. I was like, "Ha, civics padunga, notebooks up, khola hai, light white aa raha hai, desk pe baitha hai, mast civics, darwaza band hua, civics band, real player chalu." I believe Pamela Anderson was popular around the time.
Yeah.
That is my only memory of civics.
Pamela Anderson, that's a weird guy's yeah. connection to.
We went from Zila Parishad to Pamela Anderson.
No, but that's interesting though. Like, you know, like his first memory is attached to getting his first computer with civics. That's why you remember it. At least you remember it, dude.
Because it's such a dry subject when you like, especially the way they taught it. I don't know if it's changed now. Like, I was looking at the texts yesterday. It's still, like, it's still way nicer than we just had massive blocks of text. That this is the most boring thing. Yeah. This is still better. And I believe there are better ways to teach it because it's so interesting. Yeah. The little reading that you do later in life. I'm like, this is, like, real world shit. You can give real world examples. Yep. And there's so much to be taught and all of that, but no, Zilla Parishad.
Yeah. So to move on, we are going to do our thing. So Shreyas.
Yes.
The thing. We did it for 9 episodes now. God damn it. Like, describe a place where you used to hang out with your friends.
Like in school? Yeah, I guess like the basketball court and the stage next to it, I guess. Whatever.
Basketball court and the stage.
Okay. Would you ever study there or you just hang out?
No, you'd play, you'd probably just hang out. Nobody, we had classrooms, we studied indoors, we were not in a Zilla Parishad. We didn't sit under a fucking banyan tree with no shirt on. And, no, man, we had real, like, itna bhi step chahi leta mera school. So, वहाँ पे पढ़ाई नहीं होती थी, वहाँ पे वर्कशॉप ही बहुत होती
थी. Yeah. तो वहाँ पे ही बैठे.
Yeah.
कल वाइवा.
हाँ, कल वाइवा.
On this chapter.
Civics का वाइवा होता था. चलो होता था.
Just ले लो यार. क्या करता है. तो we are preparing on chapter 9, which is called public facilities. Yes. So guys, if you want to have an immersive experience of this podcast, as I have been repeating multiple times in a sexual way, please log on to ivmpodcast.com/how-to-citizen, where you will find a drive link with this chapter in it. Yeah, so this show description, wherever you're listening to, will also have a link in it, which leads you to a Google Drive where you can download this chapter and read it with us, because there are a lot of fun pictures in it as it is. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Like usually if you see the other chapters, there is an introduction page.
Haan.
Where काफी बड़ा एक बहुत, you know, philosophical, correct, existential text है. यहाँ पे pictures है. Yeah. I mean Shreyas, do you want to begin?
Let's begin.
Yeah.
I want to begin with a very basic question to get things started. What does the government owe us? Why do we expect the government to provide us public facilities?
Because, I mean, you're entitled to that. Legally, you're entitled to it. It's part of the fundamental right.
Yeah.
Part of your fundamental rights. Also, tax. if not the government, then who?
Yeah.
Which is a question we'll explore,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
So, yeah, it is. I assume it's literally your job description. As a government, provide basic shit and, like, don't steal money. Just,
yeah.
And don't kill people.
Personally, yeah. For you, do you think the government has provided everything you have needed in your day-to-day life?
For me, personally?
For you. Yeah.
So, that's the thing, right? With people like us, we have the privilege to not be affected by the stuff, the problems that most of the country is affected by. Like, if you were to talk of water, etc., like, we've always lived in places where I've never had a dearth of water. Electricity, the biggest thing I can point to was load shedding hota tha. New Bombay mein. And that was also just New Bombay, not even the city of Bombay. That was New Bombay because of a different provider or something or whatever. And that also stopped. So, I mean, as far as we are concerned, like, we get angry about trains and buses, roads. So those are, the transport is the strongest connect that I can think of in terms of facilities for me. And there, obviously, we've been, even as a privileged person, you feel like you've been failing massively, right? Because if you've spent any amount of time doing the Bombay local train route, people like to romanticize it and say that it was, it's the densest whatever in the world, densest thing in the world, and it carries the most number of people in the world, and it's efficient and works pretty much all the time and this and that and blah, blah, blah. I'm like, yeah, but if you've spent years doing 1.5 hour one-way commutes with your nose stuck in some dude's armpit, you're like, I deserve better. And I mean, in that sense, that's the only place where you, in terms of facilities, that's the only place where you feel some sort of push and pull, because the roads are always dug up and you're always stuck in a traffic jam and traffic management is absurd, and then when they do try to build stuff, they're killing off forests. Jab train banti hai to log usme se screen tod dete hain, wo chura lete hain, to wo alag level ka scam. And yeah, so like when the metro came up in Delhi, it was such a massive thing, right?
I know.
It was such a, every Delhi person you meet today is like, bhai tu metro mein chal. I'm like, I get it, but I get trains. Like, acha hai metro, but abhi Uber aa gaya.
So, I was just about to say that, right? Like, because I come from Delhi, I hate the locals yahan pe.
Like, I did zabardast hate them. Like, it's, can I sound like a privileged asshole?
Yeah.
Okay, chalo. So basically, I used to do this a lot, right? Yeah. Like travel in trains a lot, like switch two stations, Kurla Dadar. Like, Kurla Dadar are the just the epicenter of everything that is smelly and sweaty about human. It is the worst thing. And wo maine saalo tak kiya. So when I started working, I was like, there will be one day in life where I will be able to afford to not take the trains.
Yeah.
And it happened at some point in my 20s. It happened for a bunch of reasons. And I was like, "Acha, abhi mere ko zarurat nahi hai. Main, place of work shift ho gaya mera, ghar ke paas hai. And also, baki sab auto or taxi se ja sakta, aur main auto or taxi ka paisa hai mere paas. To tab se main nahi liya. Aur oh, kya khushi aata hai mere ko. Mere ko, like, my only motivation for working is ki mere ko wo nahi karna. Wo nahi karna, yaar. Bahut, it's just too much. It's I sound like a dick, but I've done years of this.
It's very weird because I had recently I had the opposite effect, right? Okay. So basically it's a similar story, right? I used to take the metro to work. Then thoda sa privilege aa gaya, thoda paisa aa gaya, plus thoda sa work from home bhi aa gaya. So main jata hi nahi tha. Metro to sab Uber liya, ye liya, taxi liya, whatever. Recently I had to go far. नॉर्थ दिल्ली में जाना था, ग्रेट टाइम नहीं है, मीटिंग में जाना है एक्सेट्रा. टुक द मेट्रो एंड आई वाज लाइक, होली शिट, आई मिस दिस. आई लव द मेट्रो एंड आई वाज लाइक, व्हाई डू आई लव लाइक द मेट्रो सो मच. लाइक आई वाज थिंकिंग अबाउट दिस, राइट? बिकॉज हाँ, मेरी गाड़ी है, एसी है, सब कुछ चल रहा है, बट द मेट्रो, डूड, द मेट्रो, दिल्ली वाले मेट्रो में वो जो फील आता है ना.
बट डिड यू टेक इट इन नॉन पीक आवर्स?
No, peak hours.
Like the journey that you
wanted. Yeah, peak hours. But because I also realized when I used to take the metro, there were like a few lines which had not opened up.
Right.
So now, because so many circular, weird, bizarre lines have opened up, itna traffic kam ho gaya hai, to it's like, yaar, pura train mera hi hai. Like, you know, this what used to be the busiest lane is now the non-busiest lane.
Huh.
And because aaju baju se sab parallel raste ja rahe hai wahan pe. So I was so happy. Now I'm going to take the metro all the time.
Wow.
I was like, fuck Uber.
you have gone into nostalgia mode. you're like white people who come to India and be like, oh my god, I want to live in like a 500 rupee room. Are nahi tu AC wala kamra le le yaar, tu mat ja aisa hill station mein 500 rupee, tu le le kamra Goa mein.
Hey, metro by default AC hai, by the way. All compartments are AC. यहाँ पे तुम लोग प्रिविलेज करके लाइक.
हाँ, नो, आई एग्री. हमारे अभी मेट्रो बन गया, ऐसी बात नहीं है, थोड़ा बहुत चलता है.
We are going to move on to the first page of the chapter. Yes. The thing is about this chapter, which is very interesting, they have also mentioned Delhi Metro and Bombay Metro both. There are pictures of it.
Pachari Sheila Dixit ko itna hate mila. She's like, मैंने मेट्रो बनाया, guys. हाँ, लेकिन तूने चोरी किया. Fair, both sides are fair. Both arguments are valid.
Metro बनाया पर मैंने चोरी भी किया. So, यहाँ पे basically it's a very interesting way to introduce public facilities here, and they have done it through water, right? Throughout the chapter, it's about water, etc. It's a picture of two very sad looking children who are, I think, sitting in a bus. First, वहाँ पे first chapter, first page पे, and their names are Amu and Kumar. Right? Amu and Kumar are traveling through Chennai in a bus. As they go around the city, they observe the water facilities available in different parts of Chennai.
Sure.
Right? So there is a picture of Annanagar, and there is a dude called Ram Gopal who seems to be a seth.
Yeah.
And someone is washing his car with entirely too much water. Like, if you see, it's like slime or something. Clearly they have entirely too much water.
Yes, soap.
And then there is Saidapet, where Padma is standing in a line with a lot of pots with no people. And waiting for the water to come in a tap. Then there is Madipakkam, where Siva, I don't even know where Siva is, because there is no Siva in this this picture? Did you see? Yeah. There is just a bottle of water.
Like the big can of water. 20 liter, whatever.
Yeah.
Big bottles.
Yeah, and it's just like a room with like bottled water with a glass. Who does that? But okay. And then there is Mylapore where there is a water tanker. Right, and people are taking water from the tanker, and there is Subramanian written on it. Right, so basically, as Amu and Kumar are protagonists for this chapter, we're traveling through Chennai.
Yeah.
They see
that
there are different ways to get water.
Yeah, because first of all, what is this water tourism bus? Yeah. On your left, you will see a rich asshole. If you go further to your right, you'll see lots of poor people standing with buckets and no water.
Also, how did the bus go inside the room, man?
I think it ran over Shiva. That's why there's no Shiva.
I guess. But it's very interesting because the thing they are trying to show is there are certain privileged people who get water. Yeah. There are some unprivileged people who do not get water.
Well, I do like those. If you're what class is this for?
Eighth.
Yeah, it's within four pictures you get the entire summary of the situation.
Yeah.
So it's a great way of introducing it to kids, I suppose. The contrast, it's very
evident.
It's very direct. It's very direct and very evident. And and then of course they go into this thing, the explanation for it.
You know, that's it's very interesting, and I totally get where you're coming from. Hum jab school mein the, like, you know, long time ago, I don't think it was that interactive.
I don't think so.
I remember some comic panels, but other than that, it was just blocks of text.
Right.
Yeah, like if you have like the introduction page with four pictures, the teacher has something to work with. Right?
Yeah, and dreary text, like text that is geared towards getting marks and not really providing an understanding. Yeah. The language here is much simpler.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. And I'm entirely obsessed too much about this book. I think Shreyas has already. So we have like we have identified certain nuances. We realized recently that there are comic panels, and there is a chapter 1 where there is a Mrs. Rao, and then in chapter 6 there is a Mr. Rao. In chapter 1 Mrs. Rao is like a weird teacher. In chapter 6 there is a Mr. Rao who is a corrupt police officer. And then I found so many similarities between different characters. It's a Marvel universe in here, okay?
Yeah,
it's as we have mentioned
before. Civic cinematic universe.
Yeah, yeah, civic cinematic universe. It's fun.
Or the writers could not think of more South Indian names. Like Rao and
Mr. and Mrs.
Or we have spent entirely too much time on this book and we are making up things.
Do something fun, like on the metro or whatever, I don't know.
Yeah.
So in this Marvel cinematic universe, is this like a main problem in the city that there's no water, from the images?
They have given it in the paragraph as well, right? There, where
what is the situation in Chennai? Sorry, I don't know.
So
what is the situation like in Chennai?
So in Chennai there used to be a very big problem, right? And then private companies have taken over the supply,
right?
But there was this IAS officer, I forget her name, who made water harvesting a big thing.
Yes
which is mentioned in this book very barely, but the amount of work she's done on water harvesting is quite amazing, where you know, obviously, like, every house has to be compulsorily fitted with water harvesting equipment, etc. So it has made like quite a lot of difference in the water situation there. But what they have given in this book also is pretty accurate. Like, I think the time when they had written this is also like different.
Okay.
But they have barely mentioned that the water level, the water situation is getting fixed, etc. Right. So that is there. But like, for instance, like either, like when we look at the picture of Subramanyam, they have given the example here where water is purchased for tankers. Subramanyam spends up to rupees 500 and 600 per month on buying water from tankers, right? Which basically is paisa fake tamasha dekh. And I think you also like just recently spoke about it, right? Where your connect to public facilities, the basic facilities that government is supporting, is always through, say, transport.
Yeah, the biggest grouse complaint would come
from
while commuting.
Transport, right?
Yeah.
But there are obviously like much basic things like food, clothing, shelter, etc. Water being one of them.
Yeah.
The thing with water, right? For instance, like, we never feel the pain because we just, like, hamare ghar pe pani nahi hai, so we don't think twice while spending $60 for a giant,
correct,
you know, water ka can, jo baju mein mil jata hai,
right? Correct.
But for someone who is living on a basic salary and struggling, it's such a pain. right? Like to go every day and stand
we
in that line.
Cannot imagine.
Yeah.
Cannot imagine. Hamare ghar pe ek din pani aata garna jati.
Exactly.
Get so fucked. In one day, ek din kala pani aa gaya, whatever, something, and it's just weird. Destroyed. I can't imagine doing that. And the thing is, I have a feeling, I mean, it's not a feeling, it's a very foregone conclusion, but this will come for us eventually. It's the next big fucking revolt waiting to happen.
Yeah.
People have written about this.
Yeah. Water
even in
wars.
India, water, even in India context, yeah, Prayag ki jo book hai, it started with something like this.
Yeah.
And I mean, there's lots of like Shekhar Kapoor's been making that movie called Pani for like 20 years.
Yeah.
No, but in general, this is, you can see it now with Chennai, you mentioned the harvesting, you mentioned the situation getting better. Another example I remember pops out so prominently is Bangalore, man. The water situation there is terrible. You have built, dried out and built over all the lakes.
Right.
Jo char baki usme aag lag jata hai apne aap se. To spectacularly bad situation. Bombay is not much better. We are a bit in a good monsoon year and all, and with our reservoirs, I think we manage just about. But I don't know how accurate the information is. It seems better than Bangalore for now.
Right.
Delhi also, I suppose, the situation is not very good.
So again, in Delhi, it's very, very defined by privilege, right? So the area I live is divided into two parts, right? As you go southwards, every city you go southward, it's privilege, right? So I mean, like, you go southwards in, say, Malviya Nagar or whatever, like, everything improves. Because our corporator is where we live. So there will be electricity, gated colony, water will come, everything will be. But if you go northward, towards like more where students live, etc. Bahut ganda situation. Pani ka, everything, garbage, it's all trash basically.
Right. Didn't the AP try and sort that out with water at least?
So it's very interesting what the Aam Aadmi Party is doing, and since we are on the topic, guys, this is not a partisan broadcast. By the way.
Are, but wo hai government telling ki hum sharma kyun rahe? Like, we fucking get scared. Talk about Aam Aadmi Party, like, wo lashkar ka support kare. Man, wo democratically elected party hai, wo chief minister hai. Are you kidding? Of course you can talk about it.
And also, no, because also Aam Aadmi Party is relevant here because of a very simple reason. They've done immense for public facilities, right? And that is why like schools, water. So what Aam Aadmi Party has done very cleverly, I would say, is that they have identified focus areas where there are people without privilege. Privileged log to paisa phek ke tamasha dekhte hai. It's very obvious, like we are like Subramaniams who are ordering tankers and paying for them, but they have identified people who have no option but to depend on government services, which are like slums and which are like, you know, unlicensed colonies, etc. And there they have fixed situations.
Right.
They have fixed schools, they have fixed water, they have given cheaper electricity, and that is where it matters, right?
Yeah.
And I think your first question, which was, you know, how much does government matter? How much do you want government to do for you?
Yeah.
I think sitting here, we can say, नहीं चाहिए, मतलब मैं कर लेगा. मतलब फिर भी मैं Uber ले लेगा या फिर कुछ भी कर लेगा, right?
Correct.
गाड़ी खरीद लेगा, you know, कुछ भी कर लेगा. But for someone, if you ask, like in a very poor locality in Delhi, कि government तुम्हारे लिए क्या करती है? Like सब कुछ करती है.
Yeah,
my baap hai hamara wo.
Yeah, we should not be the baseline. There is a lot more to be achieved. And honestly, though, if facilities were better, there would be more people taking, for example, public transport, etc. It would not be a chore or a hassle, right? In in a better world.
Yeah.
But when you say water situation improved, yeah, how? Like, because there is a dearth of water is the perception. And the solution to that is people say, no, there's no dearth, it's just mismanagement of how it goes.
Distribution.
So is that what they fixed?
Yes, so that was essentially right? For instance, in places like Savitri Nagar, there was a giant tanker mafia, right? And they have subtly mentioned tanker mafia a bunch of times here. And it's in every city. In Bombay, it's there. In Delhi, it's in Chennai, everywhere. Wherever there is water shortage, there's a mafia.
Right.
So like, the characteristics also in the chapter they have mentioned are pretty accurate. Where they're like, the mafia basically takes over the farmland and their groundwater and then feeds it into the city. And it's very accurate, right? So essentially that is what was happening in Delhi, right? But here what they did was, you know, they actually improved the distribution of water in, you know, places where it's required. And there was a lot of blowback, though.
Like, I can imagine.
Violence and, you know, a lot of weird things that happened.
Lots of stuff I imagine we haven't even heard about.
But that's the thing, right? You know, like, I mean, it feels like when I read this chapter, for instance, it feels like a slap on your face.
Hmm.
For instance, like if you look at like all these examples, right? There is a question in the end which actually I'll just read that end question to point it out, right? Do you think the distribution of public facilities in our country is adequate and fair? Give an example of your own to explain, right? Yahan pe na 8th grader kya bolega?
This is the end of the chapter though, but kya bolega, huh?
Exactly. Like, so for instance, you, who came from APJ or non-privileged school, would have a different answer than someone who came from, say, ERA International or whatever.
Hey man, it was the best school. No, it was a privileged school. It was generally privileged school. Yeah, they would have different things to say. Private school tha wo bhi.
Yeah.
They would have different things to say from kids who were dependent on a midday meal scheme in a, you know, government school. Obviously, worlds apart.
Yeah.
As an 8th grader, especially if you're leading a privileged life, you have no perception of what the government's doing, what you need, what you... Like, 8th mein kya pata hota
tumko?
Especially if you're privileged.
Yeah.
So, yeah, bacha answer karega, I think the government is doing a fair job, but with like, it'll be some half-ass bullshit.
And it's very weird because... So, the school we went to, so me and Shreyas went to the same school, right? Modern school. We went by bus. वहाँ पे तब उस टाइम पे कोई और स्कूल नहीं था जो बस से लेके जाता था.
अच्छा,
या तो मतलब नागपुर में.
Oh, you said modern. I just assumed Delhi.
Yeah, so it's like no, not mod. That modern is different.
It's a rip-off. They're not.
It's a cheap product from Palika Bazaar. Yeah. So it's like हमारा स्कूल जो था वो बस से जाते थे. काफी अच्छा लगता था. Whatever, but it was like a prison, right? You know, like you're far away, you go inside, whatever. The point where I realized how shit our school was when it rained. Do you remember?
Yeah.
It flooded. Like pool. Nobody's business, it flooded. And this first floor was the ground floor suddenly. And you had to swim to, you know, whatever, do whatever. So, kitna bhi privilege le lo, that is the point where you realize ki, yaar, गवर्नमेंट ने कुछ तो भी गड़बड़ किया.
छुट्टी मिलती थी ना और क्या.
और लेप्टोस्पायरोसिस भी मिलता था. बट आई कांट बिलीव आई फॉरगॉट दिस. यस, तो पब्लिक फैसिलिटीज में दिस वुड कम इनटू प्ले. आई सपोज इट्स अ सबसेट ऑफ कम्यूटिंग. आई डोंट नो, बट या द फ्लडिंग सिचुएशन इन
मुंबई. फ्लड्स, या
स्पेक्टेक्युलर. वी स्पेंड so much time writing about it, so much news print, so many TV debates, और हर साल वही. Oh, it's flooded again. Wow, what a surprise. Again, the only solution is privilege. Agar tum bahar ho, ghar pe ho, to tum bach gaye. If your house is in a decent thing.
Yeah.
Literally, that's it. It's just coincidence. It's appalling.
Yeah, and this is where we have to take a break, a short break. And after we come back, we are going to ask some very, very important questions, which is about privatization. See you in a bit.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to another awesome week on the IVM Podcast Network. If you aren't following us on social media, please make sure that you do. We're IVM Podcast on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. Just a couple of notes up front. One is that we are still running our listener survey. That's ivmpodcast.com/survey. The survey is only going to run till the end of the week. So if you want a chance to win that awesome mug that we're giving out, please make sure that you fill out that survey. Also, I wanted to put out a quick reminder that if you're enjoying what you're listening to, please take a screenshot of what you're listening to, tag us on Instagram, and we'll put that in our story so that everybody else can see what you're listening to. Also, please don't forget to put in a comment. On Cyrus Says, Cyrus is joined by lawyer Ambar Rana, who talks about his family's army background, how jingoism is detrimental to patriotism, the noteworthy cases in his law practice, and how he addresses them on his podcast, Know Your Kanu. That's on the IVM Network. On episode 2 of our new foreign policy show, States of Anarchy, Hamsini talks to Dave Salvo and Brett Schaefer about Russian hacking in the U.S. elections. On How To, Citizen Meghnath and Shreyas are joined by comedian and satirist Ashish Shakya to discuss Chapter 9 on public facilities. On the Sponge Podcast, Ambi explains why it is consequential to set expectations on a realistic level and then slowly elevate them. On Shunya 1, founder of Ayopo, Chirag Kriplani, joined Sheila Ditya to talk about the growing Indonesian tech startup culture. On Ganatantra, Saryu and Alok are joined by expert Venkat Anand to discuss the influence of social media in the coming elections and how it has changed the playing field. And with that, let's continue on with your show.
All right, welcome back, guys. We have Ashish Shakya here. Ashish, I want to ask you a question, a very important question. Why does water flow in a trickle in summer in most places in India?
That was very dramatic. Why does water flow into you? Like, it sounds like somebody doing a monologue at Prithvi. Why? Because I think the answer is in the question. It's summer. And we have no management resources, right? Obviously, we know. We're not surprised that it's summer. It's fucking summer. Most of the time in this country, in a lot of the places, it's harsh and it's brutal. Yeah. And it's dry. And by now, we should have figured out how to store water and harvest it for the times it's not raining. A lot of it, is area specific. So the kind of farming practices and the kind of liquor and sugarcane mafia apparently that have stolen all the water in various parts of the state are one reason that's specific to, I think, Maharashtra. But in general, I think it just comes down to
heat.
It comes down to we just don't have not actively figured out how to manage supply. Yeah. I mean, there's lots of reasons, but it effectively comes down to that.
I think that says something, the fact that our answer was heat when we discussed this before. Yeah. The fact that we are so eager to just forgive our government for everything by blaming it on weather.
That's true. It's like, also, yaar, garam hai yaar, kya karega? Also, government bhi kya karega?
It's not like aaj heat hua. Pata heat. Hum yahan pe reh rahe hain. Hum bahut saalon se India mein. Humko maloom hai ki garmi hota hai.
Agle saal
har saal se. Oh shit, phir chalo. Oh, did not see that coming. Damn it. Next year, next year,
yaad rahega. So he asked this question because it's actually in the book.
Really?
Yeah, it's right here, first page. It's like, why does water flow in a trickle in summer in most places in India?
The answer to that should be lol, pehli bar India. Also, I think because of our spectacular corruption in this regard, we will milk and steal and strip dry any resource that is available. So even if it rained all day in India, we would find a way to go, yaar, paani shit kidhar gaya.
The book actually goes into very interesting details about public facilities, right? It says that the Constitution of India recognizes the right to water as being a part of the right to life. That's under cool. Article 21.
Yeah.
Right? So Shreyas, you have read up on Article 21.
I have read up on, yes, Article 21.
This, after 9 episodes, this guy does their homework now.
I feel now I realize maybe I should start doing the research.
Yeah.
But Article 21 is basically about the protection of life and personal liberty, right? It just says that no person should be deprived of his life or any liberty except according to procedure established by law.
Yeah. And that's the most interesting part. Yeah. And we spoke about
so
this.
So official and cool.
Yeah. We actually spoke about this in chapter 6.
Yeah.
This whole thing where, the last part where except when prohibited by law.
Yeah.
So that is basically taking away someone's human right to live, which means they're being put in jail.
But if there's law behind it, then it's fine.
If someone commits a crime,
yeah,
I mean, you will take away their basic facility.
Right to liberty to jaa raha na.
Jaa raha na.
Wo,
so putting people in jail,
yeah,
is basically taking away their right to liberty, and that is essentially what it says.
Right. Yeah.
But the fact that they're actually mentioning Article 21, right to live. So what do you think is the right to live? What according to you would be the right to live?
I mean, if you're denied access to the thing that is responsible for life, then it's a pretty big thing. Yeah. It's water. It's cannot survive without that.
Yeah.
Doesn't matter if you're Ambani or some poor guy in the desert. Yeah. Like, you both need water. Little things like, okay, so when I read this yesterday, and I was like, oh yeah, obviously it to included a constitution. sab socha yaar, what?
Would you expand that definition to include any other things? There is right to water under right to life, but are there any other things that?
So there's healthcare, education, water, but other than that, would you
Netflix bol dega main, but no, I don't know what I can add to whatever the makers of the constitution.
No, but
I don't want to be the guy suggesting edits to the constitution, saying, guys, I know it's nice, but I want to make it a little crisp. We've got feedback from our readers. It's a little too long in the middle. Yeah. If I could, then I would be like, toda free speech ke liye protection bada do.
That's too much. Okay, take that back. That's
awesome. Like Netflix de denge.
Right to life mein, right to speak, basically. Like, communicate, express yourself. That's a part of liberty.
Wo to alag hi podcast.
But no, if I had to add something, no, it would be the internet. Internet, because even the United Nations has already has said that right to access to internet should be a human
fundamental human right. Have other countries implemented? I don't know.
I think Germany has. Germany has made it a right. I'm not entirely sure. I'll have to check up on that. But there are a few countries who have.
Yeah.
But again, those are first world countries who can actually give you internet wherever you go.
Yeah.
Right. Pe,
nahin, yahan pe internet hai public. Pani ne...
Pani ne...
wo... Jio pe stream karke barish dekh sakte ho. That's a problem nahin hai.
That's actually very accurate.
This is also a great segue into talking about privatization.
Yeah.
Jio.
Exactly.
When you say government, I just think of Ambani. That's the image... In my mind, they're controlling everything. Ambani or Adani. Like, it's not even whether you are... It's not between the government and privatization. It's between Ambani and Adani when it comes to electricity. Like, those are the options you have, right?
In Bombay.
In Bombay, yeah, in Bombay.
I used to be Ambani. Now it's Adani.
Now
it's Adani. And in Delhi, it's Ambani.
And I've actually brought my...
Electricity.
I've actually brought my home bill today. Because
that's awesome. That is such an uncle thing to do. Dude, like, you know the only people who collect electricity bills are uncles. I realize this. My landlord does it and my dad. Three saal pehle ka April ka bill. Ye log file.
So it says on this, very inconspicuously, like in a corner, with effect from 1st Jan 2019, government of Maharashtra has increased the tax it levies on per unit of electricity by 10 paise. So earlier it was 16.04 paise per unit and now it's 26.04 paise per unit. Starting January 2019.
That's a giant bump actually. That's actually quite a giant bump. And the thing about this is,
you know,
and this chapter goes into it as well. Mm. So electricity is a public facility.
Yeah.
It's a basic right.
Yeah.
You know, you should have electricity. Yeah. Our Prime Minister goes around everywhere saying we will now be electrified.
Yeah.
And because it is important, right? I mean, in a country like ours with so many people, so many far away, weird places of different geographies, it's a challenge to provide electricity everywhere. Let's put it that way.
Yeah.
So the government has massively failed most of the time. Mm. They have tried.
All governments.
Period. Like, you know, they, state government le lo, koi bhi government le lo, they have paid. The way out of it, apparently, is privatization.
Yeah.
But the fun thing is, nobody wants to privatize rural areas.
Why? There's no money to be
made.
There's
no profit. Because in Bombay, in Delhi, in Chennai, all of these, like, you know, pani bhi private company, electricity bhi private company, all of that. But...
Chennai, this chapter also mentions it that the government has set a cap on what they can charge. So there's some sort of balance there.
Yeah, so that happens for DISCOMs as well.
Right.
And there was a giant war that happened in Delhi.
Yes, I remember
this,
that.
Right? Where they were saying that the DISCOMs are charging more than it's required.
But when, electricity prices have come down, water prices have come down.
It has in Delhi. Because now there is like a proper, this chapter also says this, that, you know, even though the facilities have been given to the private companies, it's the government's job to keep them in check.
Right.
On pricing.
Which means the private company's job to kill out of the government. Chill, buddy. Look the other way.
But that's the thing, right? You know, what do you think about privatizing basic facilities? And no judgment here, guys. No judgment. But we start from there. Like,
my very limited understanding would be, theoretically, the government should be able to take care of the country because... Private companies operate on a profit basis, a purely profit basis, which means that the lowest common, the weakest part of society will often get overlooked. I don't know how realistic it is to expect the government to do everything well in a country like ours. Mm. So if there's some gains to be made with a public-private partnership, then yes. But then again, comes to at least looking at, controlling the private amounts and controlling, regulating them.
Yeah.
I mean, my very limited understanding is that if you can manage that, then great. Mm. It essentially comes down to, this is a very broad thing to say, but it essentially comes down to, chori mat karo. Sabke liye profit hai, chori mat karo thoda. Matlab, it's not like the government of India will not have enough money to do. It's just that the money is going elsewhere, etc., etc. I refuse to believe that, like, that old notion of the socialist notion of government sab kuch karega, wo nahi ho pata hai. But at the same time, you don't want to go completely the other way. Because, I mean, we'll benefit, maybe. But if there's no regulation, then Then after, then if there's no regulation, people like us will start complaining.
Yeah.
Which
yeah.
we already have in Mumbai.
Mumbai.
So, yeah, it's...
And it's very interesting though, like, because across the world, in... especially like first world countries, etc. Even in India now, there's this conversation going on about limiting government.
Mm.
You know, because there is this belief now, essentially, that the private companies do the job better. Agar tum profit ke liye kaam karega, tumko profit chahiye, to fir tum facility bhi achha dega. Mm. That is essentially the belief behind privatization, right? Like Air India, that shithole of a airline, has been sucking on taxpayer money for years.
Correct.
Right? There is still... conversation going on, and I'm doing air quotes right now, about privatization. Like divest.
Yeah.
You know, government, tum apna hata lo tumhar paisa yahan se taxpayer ka aur de do private company. Right? But the problem is though, airlines, otherwise, like all private airlines, there are many private airlines who are running in profits now. Earlier it was a loss making business, but now there are airlines which are making profits. Why can't the government do that shit? Why?
With specifically to Air India, I don't know. Is it a pride thing? Is it something else? My assumption always is when something is functioning terribly, but it continues to function, is that someone is making a profit of it. It just helps somebody. So I don't know who that somebody is, how it works out. But it's the same thing with roads. Like if Mumbai, it's the biggest problems. A road banta hai, 2 months baad it gets breaks, so it's repaired again, then it breaks again, then it's repaired, and the contracts go out to the same people, and they get the same shitty meter and keep doing that again. Because it benefits somebody. The day it stops benefiting somebody is the day they'll stop doing it. So my understanding is the same for projects like Air India or any other sort of big failing, where at the very least, even if it's not benefiting somebody, the act of changing it is too much. It's too big, and it's impossible. Or if you do it, it won't matter. It won't give you an electoral gain, for example. So,
or it might be the other way around. You might lose a lot of votes.
Yeah, like a bad example would be it's not connected to public facilities, but 377.
Yeah,
no party will fight for it.
Yeah,
because it even if they want to do the right thing, which they don't, it will not give them the gains they want electorally. So why would they put them? So, I mean, that's a very broad understanding of it.
I just think it's insane that, like, I feel it says so much about what the state of public facilities is in India, that when we are talking about roads and we are talking about who the roads benefit, we are talking about the people who make the roads and not the people who are going to use them.
That's actually true.
It's crazy.
Because, that's actually a good point. Like, you know, we are talking about contractors.
Yeah. We are not talking about people who are going to use the roads.
And I'm just like, yaar, tum kha lo thoda paisa. Public private partnership ho jo bhi ho, kha lo, tum apne dost ko contract de do, let as long as they do a good job. Take money, just make a road. I don't care. Then just take 10%. 10% of thousands of crores is a lot of money. Kitna chahiye? Thoda road. Koi tere ko ishte bolega. Tu kha bindas, tu road bana. It's everyone's happy. Nobody expects one utopia where like nobody takes bribes. That doesn't even happen in China, which is called like the most non-corrupt order.
I have an uncle. Who was telling me this weird story, right? And this is, you cannot find sources for this, so don't take this for like source dikha. Mat karna, please. Okay, but story bata raha hai. So, ki ek pehle party hua karti thi 2014 se pehle.
Jo 2014 ke pehle India tha. Mujhe to laga abhi banaya. Uncle ne banaya abhi to uske to pehle to hum gufa mein rehte the. Hum patthar khate the.
Guys, to the listeners, 2019. Is right now at 2014 ke pehle bhi India tha. Koi ek party thi. Pata nahi kaun si thi.
Okay.
To unka wo jab road banate the, apparently 10% lete the. Commission. Right? Contractor se commission. Fir party change ho gaya, ab dusra party aaya 2014 ke baad. Kaun sa pata nahi.
Pata nahi
kaun sa.
Hum to India ki baat nahi kar rahe.
Kaun sa bhi party aaya. And now apparently they have done this weird thing where they are giving contracts to 10 people instead of one person. And each of them is giving them 3 to 4% commission. Right? So divide kar diya, unke paas paisa zyada aa raha hai, projects bhi zyada ja rahe hain, roads bhi zyada ban rahe hain, sab kuch ho raha hai, but the quantity has increased, the percentage has reduced, but it is ending up more than the previous party's commission.
But is work getting done?
Yes. Okay. That is the important point. Yeah. Where are the roads getting built? Huh. Good roads? Huh. We'll see.
We'll see.
Because abhi to bane. Like,
also with these projects, I didn't know about this, but with these projects also people forget that it's not like a new government comes and they start everything from scratch.
No.
They take existing shit, sometimes they rename it, sometimes they don't, because a lot of the existing shit has been in the works for years. It's the work of thousands of people, bureaucrats and politicians and whatnot, and lots of stakeholders who have put their mind behind it, and then they've created something, and then either it gets implemented as is or it's modified, etc., etc. Something that was planned but was not implemented back then is now implemented. So that thing of credit, which I find ridiculous, it's like if you took over as a CEO or whatever, like a manager in a new office, you're not going to be like HR pura hata do. Nahi, tu pehle wala system use karega na, thoda change karega usme, to
thoda efficiency badhayega,
thoda idhar udhar
innovate karega, kuch to karega, but log wahi rahenge, department bhi wahi rahega,
more or less
to naam change kar denge.
Naam change.
So like, for instance, in this book, what they say about the government's role, it's very interesting. The given that public facilities are so important, someone must carry the responsibility of providing these to the people. That someone, in quotes, is the government. Like, for example, what profit can accrue to a company for keeping the drains clean or running an anti-malaria campaign? A private company will probably not be interested in undertaking such work.
Right.
I think this is wrong though.
Okay.
If you look at the examples around the world, the richest people right now, like for instance Bill Gates, etc., are doing like shit ton of philanthropy. But main third world mein se polio hata dega.
Malaria hata raha hai.
Like the super ambitious goals, because unke paas itna paisa bhi hai.
But they're not doing it for profit, right?
Yeah.
Which is what the
essentially that is. Like, you know, that they are saying that they're not doing it for profit, right? But there's a very interesting theory, right? I was reading up on it, that philanthropy is basically setting the policy agenda, right?
Okay.
Because the top 1%, the richest people, because the world is seeing extremely inequal inequality is crazy right now, right? And that is also like related to public facilities, because the moment inequality increases, there is like a clear division of who is using what the government is giving you versus who is just building their own shit and doing whatever they want, right? There is a bubble that is created. So the theory is that because, say, Zuckerberg and all these people are spending so much money on philanthropy and spending so much money on, say, disease eradication or literacy, they have their own ideas of how it should be done. So they are essentially making policy.
That helps. Especially because when you want their money, then they are looking at it and going like, I want to spend this way. Pockets aap nikal, pockets aap nikal.
But the best example to give you is basically they are businessmen who made their business and now they are trying to do social work. Right? It's like basically saying that Ashish, tomorrow you have to go and fix like a airplane. Right? Nahi kar paoge tum. Tum engineer ho.
कैसा कहा गया है मेरी डिग्री पे भी लिखा है टेक्निकली कि इलेक्ट्रॉनिक्स और टेलीकॉम की डिग्री है
ओके रॉन्ग एग्जांपल टुमारो से इफ यू हैव टू गो एंड यू नो फाइट अ केस इन द कोर्ट
नाउ यू आर कटिंग इट टू क्लोज टू होम Too real.
I'm just saying it's the same thing. Yeah. So नहीं कर पाओगे तुम.
हाँ नहीं.
Training ही नहीं है तुमको.
सवाल ही नहीं.
तो क्या कैसे करोगे?
जान देना is not a legal answer. बस क्या भाई नहीं है कहला. I can't do that. So.
But the point about, you know, we should talk a little about reduced government here, right? So does this essentially mean that we are sort of moving towards a time when public facilities should be handled by private companies because they do a better job? Or B, profit is what motivates people, so that is how it should work? So, and C, as a result, should government just move away?
Oh, I know you need a solid, stable government. You can't all let it be run by companies. Also, with like stuff like, okay, the drains and malaria, all of that, right? Like the direct way of saying is that there's no profit for a private company to be made there, for example. But it's, so the government should take care of it. But even for a government, if you don't take care of it, that is a healthcare cost. That is a human resource cost. You have all these people falling sick and neighborhoods reduced to just disease. And it's, which then ties into investment from outside into... like, it's a drain. It's a fucking liability. Why? So there is no reason why government should not look at it look and at go, it. Hey, we need to fix this. Also, because... I find it, because we're reading this book that's for the 8th standard, like you find the writing a little idealistic, right? For like you're telling, because you're introducing children to the gods, so you're like, so the government must take care of this. Like, yes, the government must take care of this. Who else will do it? That's how an ideal situation. And then once they grow up and become cynical, they're like, "Ahai, theek hai, chal, achha, yahan pe naya wala malaria spray, main ghar pe ye laga lega, main pest control kar lega, whatever." Right? Like it's that it, in terms of privilege. So I my limited understanding of economics tells me that you can't just let it be run by corporations, because that never ends well. it's, I mean, with a country like India, it's people talk about Iceland and like the Nordic countries, Scandinavian countries, about how they are perfect models of socialism, etc., etc. I'm like, tere country mein char log hai. Mere paas char log hota, main bhi sabko healthcare aur education aur mass road aur sab deta tha. Main bhi clean energy aur fossil fuel independent ho jata. The problem is we have we like saying we're the world's largest democracy, but our problems are because we are the world's largest democracy. So essentially, it's a really a better, you need better management. And it's a dumb obvious thing to say. So that's my understanding of government and private companies, is that you can align and work together and even take money to bana dena yaar, tu bana na yaar, please. So do cheez mere ko government se na, basically do cheez hai, tu bana aur tu maar mat kisi ko. Basic. It's I not that's basic shit. मैंने बोला कि हाइपर लूप बना और मेरे को तू बस रोड बना और ट्रेन डाल और मार मत. It's not difficult, guys.
That's a great way to put it. तू बना मार मत किसी को, खत्म, तेरा काम खत्म.
और कुछ मत कर, you don't have to be cool, you can whatever, like just
do your shit and get out, basically. Ashreyas, what do you think? More government, less government?
I think less government. Definitely.
Really?
I don't know if corporations are the answer, but I don't think more government is the answer.
Why would you say that?
I don't know. I just have a distrust of
government.
Governments.
That's also one more reason, actually. Hmm. Reasonable, actually. Yeah. And also the distrust also stems from bureaucracy.
Yeah, it's lethargic.
It's lethargic. Oh, bahut slow chalta hai. Kya hai, kya kar rahe.
Ek cheez tumko karni hai, toh it goes through 10, this 10, whatever. Yeah. Like decision making is influenced by reasons that, by factors that are not related to the issue at hand. So, electoral politics will come into electricity situation or a land acquisition situation and so on and so forth. Caste and religion will suddenly come in and you're like, wow, mereko to train banana hai. You know what I'm saying? So, yeah, there's a lot of that. So I'm also not in favor of more government. I'm just not in favor of everything by cooperation.
Everything by cooperation.
There's a balance to be achieved.
Yeah. In like for instance, 93 mein tumne howitzer banane ke liye ye kiya ki design karenge. Abhi hua. 2019.
Oh, really?
Yeah, that photo of our Prime Minister.
With the the new.
Apparently, 90s mein it was commissioned or woh abhi aaya, to obe ho gaya. Like 2 decades it took.
So electrification wala bhi to wohi tha. Arey ho gaya. Arey but most of it was done. Pe. Haan, lekin char baki mein humne lagaya. And also that I love the definition of electrification since we're talking about it.
Yeah, yeah.
The government definition, correct me if I'm wrong, is 10% of the village houses in the area. Are and electrified, that means the village electrified.
And
right?
The public buildings.
And the public buildings. Public buildings. So 10% is yours.
That's very good. Crazy. It's so here's the funny story, right? So I was working in Orissa, right? And when we went to villages, such an obvious problem. Electricity hai nahi, right? You know, like whatever. Electricity nahi hota tha, to ek to Chinese solar panel lag jate the. Kafi log. And the Chinese solar panels are connected to two things. Phones and table fans.
Okay.
Right? Phones and table fans. Because fair. Electricity nahi hai, par ek bahut bada tower hai, jisse 3G aur 4G sab kuch milega. It's crazy. Like basic needs zero. पर फोन कनेक्टिविटी फुल, तेरा यहाँ पे टावर बना है उसको इलेक्ट्रिसिटी मिल रहा है ना, खुश रहो,
पंखा है ना,
पंखा है और बाकी सब सूरज देगा.
अरे this reminds me, I was reading about अभी MP में state elections हुए थे, and I was reading a quote by some farmers, I think, or some villagers. They were quoted as saying that we like this guy, I'm forgetting which one they were talking about, we like this guy because the incumbent at the time, we like him because he has come in and now electricity we get for some 5-6 hours a day or 8 hours a day or something like that, he said. Some really abysmally low number. And he's like, we get this because of him, so we like him. And I'm like, that's your baseline. Like, I'm not 8-10 ghanta milta hai. So we are, oh God.
But it's you're actually right about the definition, right? So because if you're saying that pura 100% electrification ho gaya, if you change the definition though, jaise for instance tum road bana rahe ho, we are building 37 kilometers now per day or something, right? Ab tumne pehle jo measurement ka jo tha ki road per kilometer kitna hai, wo change karke do lane agar tum count karoge, do road,
like, right,
it's a weird thing. You're playing with data, manipulating it to no end, and basically saying ki haan sab to mil raha hai, kya complete kar rahe ho tum log, whatsapp forward padhna tu, kya bol rahe ho.
My favorite was when they inaugurated one new, I think Noida wala tha, kuch
tha, expressway,
aur fir uske baad barish ho gayi, flood,
flood ho gaya, phatne laga
inauguration ke baad. There was that Hindi news anchor who did like a really sarcastic report on it. I'm forgetting which channel it was. Bechara shayad
ABP mein tha shayad,
I hope he's still there. Bahut funny tha.
So I just have one question.
Yeah.
Public facilities, so this chapter, one thing it talks about is how its benefits can be shared by many people, right? If that's the case, why, am I just misinformed, but why aren't public facilities more at the forefront of issues between parties? Like, why isn't that the main thing that everyone leads out with? Because there's no one who can not agree with, like, a public...
Lekin ye, jaisa YouTube pe hota na, catchy or relatable chahiye, to Hindu-Muslim wala relatable hai. Electricity wala is like, haan, theek hai, jo bhi hai, lekin wo dekh, kya usne kiya mandir mein, wo
viral in the Muslim
viral nahi jata hai, electricity wala boring hai.
Boring
hai. I suppose, I don't know.
Yeah. No, because I think you're right, like, for instance, like, let's take the instance of this, right? Hum abhi itna baat kar rahe hai public facility, but one thing we understand and one thing we agree with is ki sab shit tha. Sab government ne shit kaam kiya, abhi thoda bahut mil raha hai, we have privilege, we can throw money at things and we can get things, but phir bhi you can see some sort of changes happening on the ground through governments. Slow process hai par ho raha hai, right? Kahin privatization ho raha hai, kahin government pe hi chal raha hai, whatever it is, right? But the thing is, Arnab Goswami electrification pe kaise debate karega?
That's again such a long conversation, but it's essentially the 24-hour news cycle that appeared X number of years ago, which changed all forms of debate and discussion, right? I remember when it was just one, and it's so sad that I yearn for the days of government mandated news programming, government approved news programming. 8:30 ek aadmi aata tha, ye hua, good night, done, khatam. There is no fucking four non-experts talking about Priyanka Chopra ne prime minister ke samne skirt pehna, I don't give a shit, is Rahul Gandhi, what's his DNA and what's his janeu, it doesn't matter, what are you talking about? Bus.
Like,
best.
That's the thing, like, you know, basic public facilities have no other side. Tum kya karoge, right? Like, you know, so we can fight about privatization versus government. That is some arguments uspe ho sakte. But tum agar public facilities, electrification or non-electrification pe karoge. Matlab, will sadhu comment say ki, yaar, nahi, electrification hona hi nahi chahiye.
Luddites being
why
like
is
technology.
This a fundamental, right?
And, but if you do it right, it's not a form of working. Efficiency is not something we are used to. Even as a government, you're not used to it. So for that to be, it's, I don't know if that's their, it doesn't seem like that's a priority or a focus in any manner or form. I mean, the fact that you need to electrify villages, it should be an issue, and it's something that the city audience will not relate to, because apne ghar pe aat, and apne ghar pe matlab Bombay mein ki baat kar raha hu. Delhi is, the electricity is not great. Is it better now?
No, it's better.
It's better now, but like growing up, it was a lot of generator. And the rest of North India is still bad. I don't know what it's like in the South. It's nobody is, if tomorrow they stand up and just work on this front, there are 15,000 things the government has to work on. If they just work on this, it's not catchy, it's not glamorous. How do you milk it this thing? And it's just, efficiency is not, nobody's ever looked at efficiency goals. आपने को ये करना चाहिए. They're like जनता, they're more like rabble rousing. कैसे करेगा?
कैसे करेगा?
Yeah,
that's a very interesting thing to end at, actually, because we have actually spoken a lot about this chapter. Because guys, if you look at this chapter and read it, you will realize that we were all throughout just talking about this chapter. It's amazing how we just did it, guys. We just breezed through
organically.
It ho gaya.
We have time for one last thing.
Bolo.
One last thing. There's this one rhetoric in the chapter that's so problematic. It's at least there at four places where they talk about how people who tax us are the only ones who deserve services.
Oh yeah, that's super problematic, obviously. Yeah. People who pay taxes are the only ones. That's fucked. But is that an argument they're making? Is that like a question they throw for debate?
That is a question, but like it's always there. Like it's always at play. So it's clearly something.
I'll just
tell you where this happens, right? So as we know, Amu and Kumar are our protagonists, right? They're going around in the bus, right? So Amu says, did you notice that the roads in Saidapet were so bumpy and without street lights? I wonder what the place is like at night. So Kumar says, what better can you expect in a slum? So Amu is like, why shouldn't slums be like that?
Fair.
Shouldn't they have public facilities? And Kumar, the prick, is like, I think public facilities are all those who live in proper houses in colonies, because they are the people who pay taxes. And Amu is like, why do you say that? Slum dwellers are also citizens and they have rights too. Kumar, or the government will go bankrupt this way only.
No, that's, yeah, exactly. Exactly. That's a great capitalist impression.
Yes. Fuck you. Yeah.
But it's a good way to introduce the concept to children. And in general, I think one thing, if you want citizens to be a little more civic minded and not fall asleep at the word Zilla Parishad, you should just really teach them real world examples. This book is a bit of a start. It's a nicer than what we used to. But just the fact that this discussion is perfectly fine for a teacher to sort of at least introduce children to, or there are lots of explainers, there are lots of real world examples that a teacher and educator themselves can bring into the classroom, even in privileged situations. Nobody's saying a kid will get up and change the system. That's not what you're assuming. You just want the kid to not be an idiot,
right?
A kid to be, you just want the kid to not grow up and say, "Are slum dweller saale free ka paisa."
You don't want them to die. This is such a wrong argument also for one more reason, because this is an idiot argument, because everybody pays taxes.
Yeah.
Indirect taxes sab de. Yeah. Like, you know.
Haan, wo to, yes.
I mean, so you just
fucking specified income tax.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, but no, your direct taxes. Taxes. But yeah, what you're saying?
Yeah, so if kids, especially with this chapter in general, if you tell them basic, take them around the city, show them like people lining up for tanks. It's not one difficult field visit. Like, it's understanding of the tanker mafia, and you want to make it interesting for kids, fucking tell them stories of the tanker mafia. It's a story at the end of the day. Idhar se paisa aata, idhar se paisa khata hai, tu kuch karega, isne isko maar diya. Like, I would be interested.
Yeah.
Road construction, real estate, the fact that parks are being co-opted. Magically, there's a fire in the park.
Yeah.
Wow, that happened. I mean, there's so many ways to teach them that just you can grow up and not be a dick, and just understand that if you are anyway in a school and you're learning this in English medium, you're some amount of privilege. Yeah. Learn to recognize that privilege. Learn to see just how government functions. What are the limitations?
Yeah.
Imagine if you are in power and you wanted, like, if you
wanted to fix shit.
You wanted to fix shit. What would you think? And then play out those scenarios. Yeah. There's so much to make this interesting, to make civics interesting. And like we started talking, and I think we didn't really look at the chapter much. It was just a freewheeling. And just, that's the kind of discussion that you should have in class. And exams should be like, not an afterthought, but I don't care about your definition of fucking, you know, just
Zila Parishad.
As long as you know how things operate and how the...
I love Ashish going on a rant, and I miss it, dude. Go back to college.
This education system thing is a really pet peeve of mine. This teacher. Yes.
So I think that is where we end, though.
Yeah.
And now the surprise, we are going to score you.
Okay.
Because we were randomly teachers all the time.
Ah, done. Yeah. So, wow, yeah. This is one like Abbas Mastan. Yeah. Teacher, everything was planned.
Shreyas, you want to score him first?
Yeah. You know, when there's a flood and there's no drain and cars are floating and there's a wiper on the car, you're the wiper. That's your score.
Cool. I totally get this objective measurement system. Yes.
My score for you is tu nanga hi to aaya tha kya ghanta lekar.
Main yahi sun raha tha on the way. Fuck. Good score. Good score.
Yeah, good score.
Time aayega. Jab tak ye aayega tab tak picture nikal jayegi.
Public facilities aayenge, apna time aayega. That is it. I think you want to give a, like, you want people to follow you somewhere. You want to give a shout out.
Ashish and Shakya on Instagram, and that's where I do most of my nonsense these days. Come say hi. I perform at various, I do stand up at various clubs and bars and cafes and auditoriums across the country. So if you see a lineup with my name on it, please come. It's mostly funny.
Shreyas?
You can follow me on Instagram at Shreyas underscore Manohar and on Twitter at the rate very Shreyas.
You can follow me on Twitter at Meghnad, M-E-M-E-G-H-N-A-D, and you can follow me on Instagram at Meghnad S, and that is about it. And if you want to have an immersive experience again, you can go to ivmpodcast.com/how-2-citizen, and you can download the chapter in the description as well. Please follow IVM Podcast at IVM Podcast on Instagram and on Twitter as well. And also, please listen to other shows from IVM, guys. Yes. They are excellent. Mm-hmm. And I'm not just saying this because I'm doing a podcast with them. They're genuinely good. And thank you so much, Ashish.
Yeah, thank you.
Stupidest,
man.
Maximus. Please start column writing again. And thank you, Shreyas. And thank you, everyone, for listening. In the penultimate episode of How to Citizen, we have comedian Ashish Shakya with us. Please tune in next Tuesday to have fun with him while we discuss some public facilities.
How aware do you think you are of your laws and rights? Do you look up to laws when you are caught up in situations? Do you know what your rights are when you're stuck somewhere bad? Well, here's a show that can help you move an inch closer to being aware of what your rights are. Tune in to Know Your Kanoon with me, Amber Rana. This is a podcast meant to answer all your law-related queries. Catch Know Your Kanoon every week on the IVM website or the app or anywhere you get your podcast from.
Look, up in the internet. It's a meme. No, it's a cat video. No, it's the Geek Fruit Podcast.
That's right. We interrupt this riveting broadcast to tell you about our show, The Geek Fruit Podcast, where Tejas, Dinkar and I, Jishnu, talk about everything in pop culture, including DC, Marvel, Star Wars, Netflix and everything in between.
You know how your friends hate it when you ramble about some nerdy crap and you just want somebody to listen to you? Well, sorry, there's nothing we can do about that, but come listen to us ramble and it'll almost be like the real thing. Kind of.
Listen to new episodes of the Geek Fruit Podcast every Monday and the Geek Fruit Bulletin every Thursday on iTunes, Google Podcasts, the IVM app, or wherever you listen to podcasts. Happy listening, you nerds.